Okay, so it's time for another track deconstruction. I know you guys love it when I rip apart my tracks and show you exactly how I made them. This is a brand new EP that I've got out on Rhythm People at the moment, In My Soul and Pick Me. I'm going to show you how I made the lead track, In My Soul. I'm going to go right into the Ableton project, show you all the different parts to it, all the different instruments, where I got my samples from, and how the idea came about. Okay, so today we're talking about a brand new EP that I've got out on Rhythm People at the moment. We're going to jump into the Ableton project of In My Soul, the lead track on that. So let's get into Ableton and have a look. Okay, so there's quite a few layers within this project. I'm not actually sure where I started this track with. It might have just been the beats and using the bass and maybe some of the chords and going from there. I think I got the vocal a bit later on, once I kind of got the main idea of the track. It does kind of sound like it was built around the vocal, but I think that came in at a later stage. So really I kind of started with the drums. So if I go into the drums, let's have a look at those. I'll solo the tops and the kick. It's my kind of standard effect on the drums, really. We've got a main hat in there. Got a little skip in there, I think. So that is actually just a hat from a tops loop loaded into Simpler. I've got a bit of EQ going on within there. And as we can see in the MIDI clip here, it's a fairly standard affair, but I'm actually using one of the grooves within Ableton, the MPC Swing 60. That seems to be giving it a lot of the swing within there. So I've kind of reprogrammed that drums to kind of get that swing effect that I have in my kind of jacking kind of sound to my tracks. Also, by programming it this way means I can use that same swing on everything else and kind of have the same swing across the whole track. So it just makes it a little easier. But actually, having a look at the groove, there's a few different swings in there, so I might have actually varied it up a little bit. So we got the hat in there, we've got a clap. Again, this is probably, now this is just a simple one-shot sample, and it might even be layered. No, it's not layered, just a single clap within there. Don't know why I've got an auto filter. I've got an auto filter going on there somewhere. I think probably somewhere in the breakdown, maybe it's filtered out. We've got a snare in there. Oh, this is probably taken from a... Yeah, I'm guessing this is probably from a tops loop or something like that. It looks like it's been recorded in, so I'm not quite sure where that's come from. We've got a tops loop going on here, just some extra little bits. I tend to take tops loops a lot and cut bits out of them. So I find it's a lot easier way to kind of get ideas going when you've got top loops. You can just audition them alongside your beats and you kind of get a feel for what you want. I tend to work very, very quickly. So top loops work really well for me. So with this one, I think I've actually just taken some certain percussion element out of it, I think. Or it might just be the percussion on it, I'm not quite sure. And then we got a ride loop within here as well. Yeah, nothing amazing going on there. I've got the LFO tool, which is kind of ducking out a little bit of the start of it. Yeah, so there you go, it's quite a straight ride going on there. Get a bit of pumping with the LFO tool, so that works quite nicely. And that's pretty much my drums, really. There's not much going on there. So let's move on to the bass, because I'm guessing that's probably where most of this kind of was centered around. So I am actually using, first of all, I'm using the scale plugin, which is one of my favorite plugins within Ableton, just to keep all the notes that I've got in there within the scale of whatever I'm working in. So this is actually an A minor. So I tend to work from the C minor preset and then adjust the bass from that. So this is now in A minor. I'm also using one of the inbuilt Ableton bass presets, Deep Chill Bass. This works really nice. I quite like this sound. I've used it in a couple of tracks. Needs a little bit of tweaking here and there on the EQ, but it works really nicely. And I've also got the Renaissance bass on there just to kind of bring out some of the top end. It probably is quite subby. Yeah, so it's quite a subby sound, and putting that Renaissance bass on there just kind of adds some extra harmonics to the top just to bring it through the mix a little bit. when you're working with kind of bass heavy kind of tracks, or at least when the bass is kind of needs to be present, that's part of the melodics of the track, the character of the track, then sometimes you need to bring out the top of the bass. And the Renaissance bass works really well for that. I really like that plugin. That's a plugin from Waves, if you're not familiar. I tend to use that quite a bit on a lot of my sub basses. Next up, we have Neutron 2. Again, one of my favorite plugins. I've gone over this in a previous video. I've used a track assistant on this to kind of get a good start from it, but then I've also tweaked the equalizer here. So I've definitely rolled off quite a bit of the bottom end. So we can see that about 50 hertz. So we're getting rid of a lot of the sub rumble from that. And I've also taken it down a little bit. Well, around about 80 hertz as well. I think it's probably one of the notes from within there that was kind of peaking a bit too much. It's also in dynamic mode, so it's only affecting it once it goes past a certain threshold. So you can see it kind of works a bit more sometimes and a bit less other times. So it's got to go past that certain threshold for it to actually take that band down within the EQ. It works really, that's one of my favorite things about Neutron, is the dynamic mode on the EQ. Really love that. The Exciter probably, again, gives it a bit of upper harmonics and kind of works with that a little bit. So it punches through the mix a bit. I'm not entirely sure what the compressors are doing, but it sounded better with them on than it did with them off. So I kept them on. And then finally, we've got the trusty LFO tool there. It's literally just ducking the kick. That's what it's doing. Now, I could sidechain, but to be honest, I just prefer using the LFO tool, as I do with pretty much all of my tracks. So we've got that within there. Let's have a look at the music. So this is just, I tend to group up my music elements when I've kind of got a load of different pianos or different musical elements, and I want to put a filter over all of them. Maybe I want to take it down, and that's generally why I kind of group them all together. So let's have a listen to these. So we got a really luscious pad in there. So that's actually, I think that's probably from a sample somewhere. I think maybe from Splice, I think. Yeah, so I've actually used that kind of Rhodes just on its own, actually. It kind of works really nicely in this track. Sometimes I will cut stuff up, and sometimes I will kind of tweak things and transpose things as and when I need to. But generally, if it works, it works. And that kind of worked really well within there. I think I just needed something for that breakdown. We've got an upper pad here. So what's this? So I've got a stab here. So let's have a look at this stab. Yeah, so again, it's another Rhodes stab within there, and I'm kind of just transposing it. So within each one of these clips, each one of these audio clips, so I've got that, well, that's at, that's not been transposed, but this one, yeah, it's down 3 semitones. So I'm kind of matching the other Rhodes, but I'm also, yeah, so I'm using the auto filter on there to kind of just kind of bring it in. So it adds just a top layer to it. So we've got the Rhodes in there already, but I'm putting an upper layer of Rhodes in there and filtering that up. So it feels like the whole thing is kind of filtering up. Just one of those things, I like to layer stuff quite a bit and kind of create these more complex, maybe pads and stuff. Now, when you're working obviously with samples, it's a lot harder to kind of, it's not like you've got like the original instruments, which would have filters and all that kind of wonderful stuff, and you can play with velocity. Once you've got a sample, you can only affect it with audio effects. So doing stuff like with the auto filter can give it a bit of movement and make it feel a bit less static. So yeah, that's how I kind of built this breakdown here. So altogether, it kind of sounds like this. So So that's kind of, that's the breakdown of those roads. What else is in there? There's some other roads within here. So we got this other sample within here. This is quite interesting. Let's have a look, see where this came from. Okay, so this is just another held Rhodes note, but I've actually tweaked it a bit. I've kind of done exactly the same thing as I did with the other chord. So I've got it on the original, and then I've taken it down three semitones. But what I've also done is I've kind of done almost like a sweep with it. I don't know if we can see that somewhere within this clip. I might have actually just committed it. Oh no, there we go. I've got the transposition here. Yeah, there we go. So we can see it going down. So you can see it's actually starting at naught semitones and then going down to minus three. I've got a little sweep in there. So if you had a Rhodes keyboard or a piano or a synth of some sort, then you could do a pitch bend on it. But obviously, as this was a sample that I got in, you can't do the pitch bend with it unless you loaded it into a sampler of some sort. But here, what I basically did was I just kind of put that sample on the track and then just went into the clip properties and edited the transposition on that. So that kind of, yeah, it has a similar effect, and also it kind of, rather than jump in between the notes, it kind of slides into it. And I like that kind of, especially on Rhodes pianos, it's nice when it kind of bends and it just sounds kind of cool. I like that. So I do that quite a bit in my tracks. I do tend to do these kind of slopes on transpositions within audio clips. You'll probably see that with a lot of my stuff. So that's the Rhodes. We also have some stabs going on here as well. So let's have a look at these. Zoom in a bit closer. Let's get rid of this. So I'm not quite sure where these stabs are from. Let's have a look. So yeah, I'm not quite sure where I've got these stabs from. I've obviously probably layered them on in Ableton. So I put them in place and then I've obviously consolidated it at some point. So I'm not quite sure where those are from. They're probably just stabs from Splice, maybe. I tend to get a lot of my sounds from Splice, especially stabs. One of the great things about Splice is you can search by key. So it becomes a lot easier to kind of find sounds that are within the key of your track. So again, I probably had the bass. I kind of knew what the key of my track was. Then I went searching for samples that were within that key. So that's probably where I found that stab from. Now, it's not, obviously you can, you know, take another stab sound and transpose it to the key that you want. But in this case, you know, I kind of went looking for something that was already in the key that I needed it to be. So on that one, as far as effects goes, bit of EQing, bit of reverb on there. Again, these are kind of like the reverb, especially I tend to use on the default settings. Don't know whether it's laziness or the fact that I just like the sound that comes from it. But I say I just put a little bit of reverb on there. We've got the new delay effect within there. I love the new delay effect. I love the fact that it's been merged from Simple Delay and Ping Pong Delay, and they've been put together. It makes a whole lot more sense to me having all those controls in one rather than having them, you know, as two separate plugins. So I've got the Ping Pong Delay on here because I love the Ping Pong Delay and I think it works really well. It kind of spreads the mix out a bit. So yeah, that's why I've got that on there. I've also got the auto filter on there, so I can filter it in and out. I'm guessing that's probably in the breakdown perhaps. Okay, so yeah, we've got some automation here, but not actually any clips. So I probably had it in the breakdown at some point and then must have just taken it out. Maybe I just didn't like it in the end. I tend to, as you do with most production, you tend to throw stuff in there. And then towards the end of the project, you're like, well, no, I'm going to take it out. You tend to just throw tons of stuff in there. And then it's just a case of, you know, taking out stuff that just doesn't work or doesn't need to be there. So that's generally how I kind of work. So I've got a whole load of effects within here. I've got the usual standard vinyl noise. It seems to be a bit of a cliche now with retro lo-fi house. But yeah, I've got the vinyl in there. Gives it a bit of texture. We also have, I don't know what this is. Okay, so we got some background noise here. This is purely just to kind of fill out the breakdown. When, because you're working on a digital project, it can sound too clinical. And I've said this plenty of times in most of my other videos, so you know, you probably already heard this before from me, but I tend to put things in like vinyl noise, like ambient noise, just to make it sound a little less digital, a little less clean. And it works, you know, it usually works better in the breakdown, so it doesn't sound as clean and maybe as empty. So yeah, that's kind of what I do with that. We've got massive in here for some reason. I don't tend to use massive all that much these days. Let's have a look at this. Okay, so it's a bit of a kind of a laser effect. I don't know if I've made that, or is that a, oh no, so that's actually a preset. I found this preset in one of the packs. I bought a pack a while ago and it had a whole load of effects in there that I never thought I'd ever use. But all of a sudden it kind of came into its, yeah, it just seemed to work. I think it's in this one, the classic house one. I think it's within here. Yeah, so it's within here. So it's this classic house synth pack of some sort that I got for Massive. And I'd say it's just an effect, really. Again, it's one of those things, you know, I could have created from scratch. You know, it's a laser sound. It's pretty standard. But I thought, well, you know, there's already a preset there. So I kind of went for that and I kind of tweaked it to how I want it. Presets are a great way to kind of get started. And as I keep saying, the most important thing is to move quickly with your tracks and not think about it too much. Nobody's going to be there sitting and judging you for the fact that you've got some kind of preset in there. You're overthinking it if you're thinking that. So yeah, I've got that effect within there. That works well. I've got a couple of other risers and stuff within here. We've got this, I'm guessing that's a riser. Yeah, another riser within here. Oh, and it's a reverse vocal. So I don't know where... This is another one from Splice. So again, I was looking for a reverse effect in the key that I wanted to. And then all of a sudden I found this reversed vocal and it worked really well. So yeah, that went in there. It's one of those things. It's a tiny little thing. It's really low down in the mix. It's, you know, minus 21 dB. So it's really low in the mix. You're not really going to notice it. It's probably not going to stick out, but it's in there and it kind of works and it kind of adds something extra. And then we have the standard white noise rise as well. So yeah, that white noise riser, that's, you know, I could probably make that myself in 5 minutes. You know, I could take any synth that generates noise and do it with that. But I've got a sample there and put it on, you know, 10 seconds later, you've got everything working how you want it to. So, you know, again, it's just one of those things. I like to move fast, so that's why I tend to use samples a lot. Not because I can't do it, it's just, and it's not really because I'm lazy, it's just the fact that it's going to take me more time. If I don't move quickly, I'm going to lose inspiration. So, although maybe it is a bit of laziness as well, I don't know. So we got most of the main elements in there. Let's talk about the vocals now, because this is kind of, I suppose, one of the most prominent parts of the track. And this is all about me chopping up vocals. So you can see here we have all these different vocal stabs here. So if I just loop this up and solo it for you. So I've chopped this up quite a bit. So if we jump into here, we can see we've got a drum rack within here. So as you can see, I've gone through here and I've actually been picking out different vocal stabs and things that I can use within this track. So there's a whole load here that I didn't use. So yeah, there's a whole load in there that I didn't really use. Now, this might have been from my personal collection of samples or, again, pulling them off of Splice. But I end up going for this loop here. So if I have a look at this loop, see if we can find the whole loop. Yeah, so this is a again, this is another loop from Splice.
Oh, in my soul, in my soul, in my soul, in my soul.
So yeah, that just loops and loops and loops. But what I did was I took each individual part of that and then cut it up. So you can see within here, and then I've got this one. So yeah, each one of them is kind of cut up in a different way, and it allows me to kind of play them however I want to. So the actual notes that I've done and the actual rhythm from it really was just me kind of, I don't know, playing around to try and figure out how this would fit within the track. I knew that vocal worked, but I didn't know the rhythm that I wanted to. So generally, I just kind of just played around with it a little bit. Now, there is a little bit of swing going on here. I got the swing 64, so that's kind of swinging it a little bit. I've even actually offset the notes a little bit because these notes, you know, some of them start, can start on the beat. Some of them need to start a little bit before the beat to kind of land on the beat, if you get me. So yeah, I've kind of played around with the timing a little bit within here. But I say it kind of works, you know, it just, it's cut up a bit. And if you hear it just on its own, in fact, let me get rid of some of the effects on here. So I've got the reverb and I've got some delay. So it sounds really kind of cut up. And generally, I probably would want it to be a bit cleaner, but I couldn't really get it that much cleaner. Like I tried to kind of fade everything off, but it started sounding too soft. And also, I think it almost lends itself to the roughness of this track, that it's kind of cut up. If we're going back to kind of recreating kind of lo-fi kind of stuff with old school samplers, then it wouldn't be as clean or as smooth and as nicely produced. It would be a lot rougher. So again, it's probably doing that kind of stuff that has kind of given it the character that it has. I have put the reverb and the delay in there to kind of soften it off a little bit so you don't notice those rough edges as much. So we've got some EQ in there as well. We've got the auto filter, again, automated kind of cutting off the top end. Again, probably one of those things in the breakdown. Got a little bit of overdrive in there just to kind of give it a bit of rawness. So it just gives it a little bit of saturation, kind of gives it a bit of distortion. I do tend to use a whole load of different things for my distortion. The saturator is also really good. In this case, the overdrive kind of worked better because I wanted this kind of overdriven sound. I wanted it to kind of really sound distorted. So I kind of added a little bit of that. We've also got the LFO tool in there, not as extreme as all the others, but I wanted it to duck a little bit. It's one of my techniques for making vocals sit within the mix. I put a little bit of sidechaining, or the LFO tool anyway, shaping, to kind of make it fit under the kick, which also kind of then makes it feel like it's part of the track a little bit more. Just one of my little cheat things for making vocals sit within the track, basically. So we've got that within there. I've also got the ozone imager on the end. So this just slightly pushes it out a little bit. If you've not got the Ozone Imager, then definitely head to the Ozone website. I think this one is still free, so you can actually get the Ozone Imager on its own. Albeit it's not a very big plugin. There's not that many controls on it. And if you wanted the full range of controls, then you'd need to get probably Ozone. The Imager within Ozone is actually really good. But this standalone plugin, which is the free version, has still got some really interesting controls in it, and it can really push your vocals wide, which works really well. So yeah, I've got that within there. We've got some more vocals as well, I think, in the breakdown. Okay, so this one, I think. Yeah, so with this sample, if I go to find this sample, again, another beautiful splice pick. So I've taken that loop and I've used the Ableton Slice 2 MIDI track facility to kind of make a new drum rack. And what that basically does is it takes all the different slices within that loop and puts them as separate pads. So it kind of cuts them up. I could have done this all manually, obviously, but there's that fantastic feature in there to do that. And it kind of worked in this case. And then what I basically did was I kind of just replayed it in a different order. So it kind of works. And again, I just kind of put some standard kind of stuff on there. I've got the EQ on there. I've got a little bit more of a boost than you'd usually put, but I was trying to give it a little bit of distortion, kind of make it sound a little bit rawer by putting that kind of, you know, that kind of really extreme EQ notch in there. I've got a bit of reverb on there. Again, it's pretty much standard settings. Ping pong delay to kind of give it a bit of width. And then again, the LFO tool in there just to kind of duck it a little bit. Now, yeah, I've got that as like a secondary vocal within there. So I had the original vocal that was going through most of the track, but then we've got like the mid track breakdown, and then it goes into more of an instrumental part, a dubbier part, but it felt like it needed something else. So that's why I put the extra bit of vocal in there. So after the kind of main vocal comes out, so yeah, it's kind of almost it's just taking a different pattern and going in a different direction with it, kind of giving the main kind of vocal a bit of a break so it doesn't get so repetitive and putting something else in there. That's kind of why I did that. And we've also got some other effects in there which didn't actually go over. We've got a little scratch in here. I'm a big fan of using DJ kind of sounds and techniques and stuff within my tracks because it just makes it feel a little bit more live, like it's being done live, and it kind of just adds a little bit more interest, and it also creates a nice transition effect as well. So there's a little scratch in there, so let's have a listen to this. Yeah, so we've got a scratch in here. Again, this is just a sample from somewhere that I've got. Nothing amazing. Again, I've got a whole load of samples like this that I've collected over the years, and you know, this one just worked in this circumstance. If I find that I want a scratch sample and it whatever doesn't work, then obviously I could create my own. It's quite easy to create your own one. But again, it's one of those things for time, you know, just for ease of use, basically, make it quicker and, you know, keep that inspiration going, keep that creativity going. You know, I tried to get it done as quickly as possible. So yeah, the scratch is in there. And again, layered with everything else, it just kind of works. So that's kind of most of the elements within the track. Let's go into the main breakdown because I want to show you how and what happens with the vocal within there, because that's kind of, I suppose that's kind of one of the most interesting kind of automation things within the track. So we've got this kind of this build up. So we have the really kind of standard snare build within here. I don't think there's anything really spectacular about this. Just snare hits on the 16ths, but with a little bit of swing. So we've got the swing 64 on there. Nothing amazing about that. I think it's probably, is that just faded in? Pretty sure that's probably got a utility on it. Yep. So the utility is just kind of fading that snare in. So depending on the effect that I want, I'll either kind of fade a snare roll in with the utility, so it just kind of brings the volume level up, or I'll use the auto filter and kind of sweep it in from the bottom end upwards. Just depends on the kind of effect that I'm going for. And in this case, just the volume thing worked quite well. But looking at the vocal, there's a whole load of stuff that's kind of going on with this vocal. So the actual end bit is being repeated. So it's kind of getting more stuttery towards the end. You've got a bit more reverb coming from it. It's got a little bit of a stutter going on. So let's have a quick look at what is going on within there. I think I'm not quite sure whether this is on the... Yeah, so this is kind of on... I don't know why I've grouped this, to be honest. It's very strange. The LFO tool, that is just taking the LFO tool out, I think. Actually, I'm not even quite sure what's going on there. Oh, right, okay. Oh, yeah, so the LFO tool here is giving it the flutter. So... Sounds weird, but yeah, that basically it's making the vocal kind of flutter like that towards the end. Let's have a quick look at what that's doing. All right, okay, so we have this kind of volume shaper here, so it's like it's full volume and zero volume, and it's kind of just increasing that, I think. So this is actually, you can see at the start here, it's at, what is it, at 0% volume. No, actually, well, minus one. I don't know why it's minus one. But basically, this shaper is having no effect here. And it's basically been, it's increasing in volume. So it's increasing on the volume routing on here. So basically what it is, when it gets to 100% on here, that's when this shaper is taking full effect. At the moment, it's not taking any effect because it's actually at zero. So yeah, it's kind of creating this kind of gating effect where makes the vocal kind of flutter. And it was just basically, I did that because it was kind of feeling quite samey towards the end of the breakdown. And, you know, you can give it all the reverb and the delay or whatever to kind of build everything up and then sweep out the bottom end, which is kind of standard affair with most breakdowns. But I wanted to kind of have some kind of build there, some kind of, you got the snare roll kind of happening, that kind of 16ths. And I almost wanted the vocal to kind of follow that. So you kind of got the, where you got the snare roll kind of, I wanted the vocal to kind of go like that. So it kind of flutters in time with it. So if you hear it back, you'll kind of hear what's going on. So it's kind of, yeah, just basically kind of following the snare, basically. That's kind of what it's doing. Probably didn't explain it that well, but hopefully you kind of get what I'm going on with that. Also, there's the auto filter happening there, so that's kind of fading in. We also got some reverb. I don't know where the reverb's coming from, or is it early on here? Oh yeah, so we have some reverb here that is being automated, so we got the reverb kind of building up towards the end of the breakdown. Standard kind of thing with most breakdowns. If you've seen any kind of tutorial videos or any of mine, you probably would have seen a very similar technique. So yeah, that's kind of what happens with the breakdown. I'm trying to think if there's anything else in this track that really is kind of, that would be really kind of cool to show you guys. I think that's pretty much it. I mean, most of it is kind of me doing my standard kind of Dirty Secrets thing. I tend to arrange the whole track very, very quickly, and then I'll go into every single bit and kind of see like, okay, how can I make this bit interesting? How can I tweak this bit? How can I tweak that bit? So I might have actually arranged this whole track without any vocal, maybe just with the drums and the bass and the stabs, and that was probably about it. I probably arranged it at that point and then came back and thought, well, okay, so what else do I need to put in there? I usually like to kind of get the arrangement going, so I kind of know the whole length of the track and where then I'm going to bring stuff in and out. And as I say, then I'll go to over every single part of the track and see where I can kind of make different changes and things like that. And I'll do that for quite a while. So I'll go over it one again, you like to kind of figure out, okay, I'm going to put some vocals in here and put them in there. And then I'll go over it again and say, right, okay, so it's getting a bit boring here, so I'm going to do some chops here, I'm going to do some effects, I'm going to do this and that. I might even like take like portions of the track out where I think it's going on too long. So you know, it's it, you know, the, I do the first arrangement really quickly, and then I go over it like several times after that, looking at every little bit in more detail to kind of think, okay, how can I improve that bit? How can I improve that bit? So that's kind of it. That's kind of the breakdown of In My Soul. That's kind of the whole track. Hopefully that's kind of gone over any of the kind of questions you might have about the track. We've gone over all the different elements of it. As I say, most of this actually was all from samples. It's quite rare from me. I usually use instruments of some sort, soft synths or maybe some hardware. But in this case, I kind of went all samples with it. There was no reason for it, just what I was thinking about on the day. So that's kind of how the track came about. So yeah, I hope this has been useful. I hope this has kind of given you some ideas maybe, or some techniques or something that you didn't know before, or maybe a different way of doing it that might be kind of useful in your productions. Anyway, let me know in the comments, let me know what you think. If you like this video, give it a like. If you haven't already, subscribe to my channel, the subscribe link down there, and hit the notification icon so you're notified whenever I upload a brand new video. I've got a ton more content like this on my channel, loads more track deconstructions. So definitely head into the channel, have a look at all the different videos that I've got there, and I'll see you in the next video.